Good morning. We shall continue with magneto hydrodynamics. And in the previous lectures, we basically looked for the behavior of plasmas that we know to be a collection of positive and negative particles, electrons and ions, which behave differently with respect to neutral fluids, such as gases, like the air that we have in the atmosphere and so on, because what we need to account for is the interaction, the Coulomb interaction between the positive and the charged particles that give rise to these two different behaviors with respect to fluids. We have seen that by looking at the displacement of particles, we can identify a shielding mechanism that takes place for these particles. Therefore, we see that if we take one particle, the Coulomb force that is going to exert, let's say, on the external forces, or let's say, better to say, given a region, the Coulomb force that is generated by that region is not the pure Coulombian force, but there is this exponential cutoff that is coming out from this from a shielding mechanism. And therefore, the Coulomb potential is not extending toward large radii, because there is this exponential cutoff, we have this Yukawa potential, so not a Coulomb potential, but a Yukawa potential, which keeps potential acting only locally. Okay, so it's a local phenomenon that occurs only between near particles that are quite near one to each other. Okay, and we've seen how this cutoff is related to the Bouillet wavelength. We then characterize the plasmas furthermore with the plasma frequency, still related to the Debye wavelength, in comparison to the thermal velocities of the particles belonging to the plasma, and we derived the plasma frequency. We characterize the time scale that the plasma requires to restore equilibrium once it has been perturbed, for example, by an extra electromagnetic waves. Then we've seen all the facts relating the propagation of waves, of electromagnetic waves, into plasmas, and we derive afterward the magneto-hydrodynamic equations, which are the hydro equations, applied for the case in plasma, and we have seen how they are modified. So we have seen we studied the energy, sorry, the momentum conservation for the Poisson equation. That characterizes momentum conservations. We then looked at the modification that we need to introduce into energy conservation. We have seen that if we look for the conservation of matter, the continuity equation, this one is unaffected. This one is not affected because it refers to matter conservation, and therefore it doesn't care about charges. Okay? So we just look how the electrons, the protons, how the species, the particles in general that belong to the plasmas are, so the density, how is it changing locally as a function of time, and that change as a function of time and the density of the particles we have in our plasma in this case are related to the gradient of rho v. Okay, so to a flux, to a matter flux. And this is completely detached from the charges of particles. Therefore, the continuity equation is unchanged. Then, what we need to do, you have seen that into the energy conservation, the magnetic field is relevant. The same goes for the Poisson equation. The magnetic field is relevant. The continuity equation not, because, as I said, it's only referred to rho v or to rho, and therefore there is not any dependency on charges, and magnetic fields are not taking, do not take any role in that. So now that we have that, we need to see how the magnetic field is evolving, because the plasma can affect the magnetic field, and the magnetic field can evolve as a function of time. And as well, conversely, the magnetic field is affecting the plasma, and we need to look how this is changing, okay? So these two equations were not referring to a given fixed magnetic field, but the magnetic field can change. So now what we need to do is to look at how the magnetic field is evolving as a function of time. Time evolution of the magnetic field, which is given by the induction equation. Which is the new equation that is required in magnetohydrodynamics, which is in addition to the ones that you have seen so far in hydrodynamics. So how is this? How does this equation look like? Well, as we said, we want to look for the time evolution of the magnetic field. Therefore, we have dB over dt, and that's equal to minus C, and then the curl of the electric field. That's the standard induction equation. So what we need to do now is to specify, so that's our target, what we want to understand. What we need to specify is what the electric field is. Okay? Given the fact that we have currents within plasma. Therefore, we need to account for that. I am starting with an assumption now that in this first derivation that I'm going to do, there is no displacement between charges. Right? Because we said that there are the electric and the ions, that in such way that they create, if you want the creation of currents within plasma, there must be a displacement. Otherwise, locally, your plasma is completely neutral, and it doesn't give rise to any current. Therefore, if you want to have current, you need a displacement between the two components of the plasmas. Positive and negative charges must drift one with respect to each other. Then you have the creation of currents. But at the moment, we are going to ignore that, okay? Because I want to show you what is relevant here. What is the impact of the currents when you have displacement? Okay, just recall you a few facts from the introduction that I did on plasmas. So we have a current. This is the one that we are observing. The one that is a rest frame in the plasma is denoted by prime. We are looking for non-relativistic plasmas, and therefore we can approximate one with each other. They are very similar, and we keep them as equal. And this is related to the electric field through the capacity of the fluid to give currents. Sigma. The conductivity. Thank you. The conductivity sigma. Okay. Then we have the relations we have seen that we have. Still, we need to account for the Lorentz transformation, even though we have. Say a small effect given by the transformation because we are dealing with a non-relativistic fluid. The Lorentz transformation must account for. Therefore, the electric field, let's do the electric list, the electric field that we perceived is related to the electric field at rest with respect to the plasma with this component which is relating the velocity of the fluid, B over C, so C, velocity of the fluid over C, so the beta factor, and the magnetic field. You've seen that the electromagnetic field is one object that lives in the Minkowski space. and when you make the transformation, you have the mixture between the electric and the magnetic field. What we can do now is we have our current, we have our electric field, we can place it, so that's prime, so this is prime as well. So we can plug this guy here, and we have the electric field as we observe it, which is connected to J as we observe it, and the magnetic field as we observe it. Okay, we just combine these two equations together as we have done already. Then we have the current, and we can relate the current to the magnetic field. Therefore, what we can do is to use the Ampere's law, which is just C over 4 pi, and then we have the curl of the magnetic field. We combine these three equations. So we have the electric field, which is a function of the current, and the current is a function of the magnetic field. Therefore, we have the electric field, which is completely related to the magnetic one. So what we do, we plug our electric field, pop, into our induction equation. And what we have is the minus, which is here, I make it bigger, minus C, and then we have the curl of the electric field once we have combined this equation, which means J over sigma. You see that J. Sorry, I'll give you the final expression because I already combined them. So it's C over 4 pi sigma, the curl of B minus B cross, magnetic field. Okay? We shall now give a look at this term. You see that we have the cross product of a cross product. So I'm now only working on this part. And we can use our usual trick because we know that we can re-express the cross product of a cross product in terms of scalar products related to the gradient. And therefore, what we get is our constant, C 4 pi sigma. We can bring it outside. We have another C here that gives us a C square over 4 pi sigma. So we have all the constants. Then we have the curl of the curl of B, which is equal to, again, our beloved constants, B over sigma. And then we have the curl. Sorry, the gradient of the gradient of the magnetic field minus gradient square B. And now what we have? What is guy equal to? Oh, well, that's equal to zero because of Maxwell's equations. Therefore, we are in the first term, we are only left with that. And it gives us our final result, which is equal to C squared over 4 sigma squared. Remember that there is a minus here, but we have a minus as well. That gives us a plus here. The constant is untouched. And then we have our gradient square B. And then we have this other factor that I didn't touch. Minus and minus give us a plus. Then we have C times beta, which is V over C. Therefore, the C cancel out. And we have the velocity cross B. But we have the curl, of course. So we have the curl cross velocity cross B. And that's what we get. So how is then our magnetic field evolving as a function of time? Well, we have two contributions, as you see. One is given by this term. We have the gradient of the magnetic field. Therefore, the magnetic field is not constant in space. We have an evolution. This would be different with respect to zero. We have a time evolution of the magnetic field. And this is related to currents. You see? Inside this magnetic field, it's hidden the current. So this is related to currents. Whereas this other term is completely not related to currents. Where was it coming from? From here. From the Lorentz transformation. Therefore, we have two terms, one and two. One is related to currents, and two to the Lorentz transformations. Furthermore, what can we notice looking at this equation? What happens if at time zero we start with no currents? What happens if that's the case? This is equal to zero, therefore the term under two it's equal to zero. If B initial is equal to zero, as well this is equal to zero, therefore the magnetic field, the time variation of the magnetic field is equal to zero. There is no, this tells you that there cannot be any creation of a magnetic field. Plasmas with this assumption, perfect coupling between the two components of positive and negative charges, no evolution of B, and if you are starting with zero, therefore B is equal to zero for all times. You don't have evolution of the magnetic field. You don't have the generation of magnetic fields. Plasmas with, again, stress it, when we don't account for displacements between the positive and the negative charges, there is no generation of magnetic fields. Okay? So that's how you read this equation. That's the induction equation with that assumption. Okay? We can now move on and loosen a bit that assumption. There is still coupling because the two particles, the two species of particles feel one each other, and therefore they influence one each other. But what we're going to assume now is that there is a little bit of drift. So we are going to loosen that assumption, which is very strong, and we account now for some displacement. So what we are going to do is to rederive the induction equation in this more relevant form, because we are accounting as well for this displacement that is actually occurring within plasmas. So what do we have? We have two charges that can move one with respect to each other. Therefore, what we need to do is to account for the fact that we don't have anymore one fluid, because in that case we have only one fluid. The two species are completely coupled together, and on average, on an ensemble, of course we have random motions, but they are displacing as a river, okay? We have only one fluid. In this case, we have two fluids. We have the ions, and we have the electrons. And for this reason, we need to study these two fluids independently. So we are going to have the velocity of the ions and the velocity of the electrons. So let's do that. We need now to characterize these two fluids with two different Euler's equations. One per fluid. Therefore, let's take the first one for the electron, and E, ME dVE over dT is equal minus the gradient of the pressure minus density, and E, and then we have the Lorentz force, electron, rho B. And then we can as well introduce gravity. Okay? So we have the Euler's equation with the contribution of the pressure, the contribution of the force acting upon the particles, And I also introduce the force of an external field. In this case, we are interested in gravity, but as well, this is just the gradient of whatever potential, so whatever force is there that is acting in the same way on the particles, that's what we have. So in this case, it's gravity, okay? The same is going to be for the ions. So it's going to be identical. I just, instead of electrons, I need to specify ions. So VE dT equal to minus the gradient of the pressure. And the pressure as well, I need to distinguish for the two cases. One is the electron pressure. The other one is the ion pressure. Minus NE, charge E. But what? For each particle, you see one particle, this is the number density, we have one charge contribution. For one ion, we need to account for the number of charge particles, number of protons that we have within our ion. Therefore, we have NE times Z. Then we have the electric field plus VE over C cross B minus NE, mass of the ion, and then the same gravitational potential. Okay, two Euler's equations, two fluids. Now, what we want to do is to look for the displacements between these two particles, between these two fluids. Okay, therefore, what we are interested in is the difference V displacement between the two species. Okay? Therefore, we are just looking at the relative velocities between the two fluids. The difference. So what we have? We have the V over the T. So you understand, if we make the difference between these two equations, we are going to have the time evolution of the difference between the velocities, which is exactly what we are looking for. Let's do that. So we have the V electrons minus V ions over the T is equal to minus, and now we have all the stuff that we have there, pressure of the electrons over NE, ME. So you see I'm bringing this NE, ME on the other side of the equation. So we have it here at the denominator, minus E, ME, and then we have the electric field plus V cross B, that is over C, yes, because it doesn't cancel out anywhere, and then we have the gradient minus the contribution from the ions, which is basically the same, except for the fact that we need to remember that we have the that we have the contribution of the number of protons in our ion, ME, then E, sorry, there is a plus because we have a minus this equation. Therefore, plus, this remains like that, VE over C cross B minus the gradient of phi. Sorry, again, there is the minus there, therefore we have a plus. What do we see here? Oh, gravity is irrelevant for the displacement of the two charges. That's related to the equivalence principle. If we have charges, what is characterizing them with respect to gravity, the mass of the particles. But if you know as well that if I have something massive or something not massive, they're going to feel the acceleration in the same way. Okay, so that's related to the equivalence principle. It's kind of showing up here. In fact, you see that the mass dropped because the contribution here is equal to that one here. Okay? But then what we need to do? Okay, that's not enough. We need to attach a patch. because what we need to do is to include as well a collision term, which is VE, V ion, over a typical time scale for collisions. Because one of the things that we've seen in the hypothesis that we placed in the derivation of magneto aerodynamics is that there must be collisions that are occurring on a specific time scale tau. And of course, the number of collisions depends on the relative flux between the two particles, which means the difference in the velocities between the two species. Then what we can do? Well, we know that we can simplify this equation, which is quite long, so we can make it shorter and simpler. And what we have to remember is that the mass of the ions is way larger with respect to the mass of the electrons. Therefore, we can basically drop the contribution between these two terms. Okay? Therefore, this is negligible. And all of this is negligible. They're not canceling each other. They are negligible with respect to the terms above. And now what do we have? Look, now the equation is kind of clean because we can isolate the electric field. We have the electric field as a function of the displacement between the two species of particles. Therefore, we have our electric field. So I'm just isolating that term, which is equal to minus the gradient of the electron pressure divided E and E minus VE cross B over C plus mass of the electron displacement over tau, and that's related to the collision term, so you see how important this guy is. And that's it. And then you can ask yourself, that's annoying, how do I know how they are displaced? Well, actually, we are not really care about knowing what is the velocity of the two different fluids. What we care about is the current that this drift is creating. But we know what is the definition of the current, right? So we know that the current is equal to the charge. In this case, we have a little volume, therefore the number density of the charge of each individual particles. So this is the density, the charge density, times the velocity. In this case, it's going to be the drift velocity. So this is the definition of the current, right? We have the charge times velocity. That's the definition of the current. And we can plug our relation to the current into here. So we have the evolution. Sorry, we have the electric field as a function of the pressure of the electron pressure, the magnetic field, and the current that is created by the displacement. That's how you read this equation. Okay? Therefore, at the end, we can now get our electric field and we plug it into our induction equation to get the evolution of the magnetic field, the B over the T equal to minus C. And then we have the curl of the electric field, right? That's the induction equation. But now we can plug it. The explicit expression that is relating the electromagnetic field to the charge current that is created by the displacement of the particles. So we just plug all of this equation into here, and we get these terms. I split them for convenience. Okay, that's our induction equation, which like this, it's a little bit hard to read. It's not that easy to give a physical interpretation of it. The moment I want to just to stress you that this is, we cannot get the number of electrons outside of this curve because this is a function that depends on the position. I remind you that whatever is the number density of the species that we are caring about, this is a function of position and time, okay? Therefore, this must be inside the operators, both here and here. Now, I'm going to call this equation 2, this part of equations 2, and this one is going to be the bit number 1, okay? This part and this part. And you see that what we have here is we have derivatives of the product, if you want to say the ratio between two functions, and therefore we need to apply the product rule for derivatives, and the same is going to apply here. Okay, we have the curl of J over NE, and they're both function of positions, therefore we need again to apply the product rule for derivatives. So let's take the bit number 1. Which is this one, okay? So we just apply the rules for derivatives of a set. Therefore we have J cross N over, gradient of N over the electron squared plus number of electrons to the minus 1. Yes, there is the curl. And then we have the curl of J. Yes. Then what we can do is to apply Ampere's law that we have seen already 100 times by now. So we have the J is equal to C over 4 pi. And then we have the curl of B. So again, we have an expression that is related to the curl of B. Of course, we plug it into here as well as here. Okay. But, well, let's make a step back. So let's give a look at J, you see it's a vector, and then we have the gradient of the number density. But what can we do here? We can do an assumption. Well, it's not an assumption, it's an approximation, that this guy actually is approximately zero. Why? Because we have a gradient in densities, so we have a region with larger densities with respect to another one, and typically what's happening is that we have a flow of matter that is going from higher density regions to low density regions in this direction. Right? High density, low density, typically we have a direction of flow that goes into this way. Therefore, we have the gradient of the number density, which shows you, right, high, low, so the gradient is pointing in this direction, which is, of course, the direction of velocity of the particles. But the direction of the velocity of the particles determines the direction of J. Therefore, we have the J and the gradient of the density are roughly parallel. And when you take the curl, the cross product between two vectors that are sort of aligned, that's equal to zero. In this case, it's not identically zero, but roughly is zero. That's because J is parallel to the gradient of the number density. Okay? Is this argument clear? High density, low density, we have a gradient which is pointing in this direction. Typically, we have velocities from here, particles that are moving from here to here, therefore we have the same a vector velocity that is along the gradient of the number density, the two are parallel, therefore this guy, we can neglect it, and we are only left with the other one. Therefore, what we have is that this guy is equal to C, that is coming from Ampere's law, 4 pi, again from Ampere's law, number of electrons. And then we have the cross product between these guys. Again, here we have the cross product of a cross product. We use once more our rule for the cross product of a cross product. So we have the gradient of the magnetic field minus the square of the magnetic field. And we have seen, as well as before, Maxwell's equation, therefore this guy is equal to zero. It's not an approximation. Maxwell's equation tells us that the gradient of B is equal to zero. Therefore, this is equal to C gradient square of B over 4 pi, and then the number density of the electrons. And this was about this term. So, you know, you see that this term that was related to the curl of the ratio between J and N, now it's related to the gradient square of B. Now we go for the other term, the number two, so this other cross product. Let's see if I manage to fit here. Yeah, I should. So the number two, so the gradient, cross product of the gradient of the pressure divided by the number density, so I'm looking at this guy here. That's equal. Again, I'm applying just the product rule of derivatives, nothing more than that, to the minus one cross PE plus NE to the power minus one gradient of the pressure, electron pressure, and that's it. That's that. Okay, but then what we see here? We have the curl of a gradient. That's identically zero. Not an approximation. The gradient of the curl of a gradient is equal to zero because the two vectors are aligned. Good. So we are left only with this guy here. Okay? But I can also do a little trick. You see, we have the gradient of this function, which is the inverse of n. So I can just apply again the properties of derivatives. So I just apply the derivatives to n to the minus 1. That give us a minus, because this minus is coming down, n to the power of minus 2. And then we have the gradient of the electron density cross the gradient of the electron pressure. Okay? In this way, we have a better expression, simpler to interpret. And now let's put all the pieces together. You see, it's also got simpler because we managed to simplify the expression by taking advantage of the terms that are identically equal to zero. And for the approximation that we are applying up there, knowing that the gradient of the number density of electron is roughly parallel with its current, with the current of the electrons. And the final result is this one. So now I'm just re-expressing the term 1 and 2 of this equation with what we derived up there. Therefore, what we have, the time derivative of the magnetic field is equal to the gradient of the electrons across E over E squared plus the gradient, sorry, the curl of V E cross B plus, right here, plus M E C squared over E squared tau N E 4 pi, and then that's our induction equation once we account for the drift. But now you can tell me, but there is this tau, that's the typical collision time. How do you know that? Well, actually, we don't care, because we can just look at the definition of the conductivity, and this tau is actually belonging to the conductivity, because this guy here is the conductivity to the power of minus 1. So sigma is equal to E squared tau n E over m E. That's our conductivity. And look now what's happening. Let's take again the case in which B is equal to zero at time equals zero. So this term drops, is equal to zero, because it's directly proportional to the magnetic field, which is zero itself. Okay? You see that this is something related to the current, because we have the conductivity here. Okay? You don't see the current because it got absorbed through the Ampere's law, which expresses currents with respect to magnetic fields. This is zero. This guy, again, is this one was related to the Lorentz transformation, directly proportional to B. Also, this guy is equal to zero. But look now, we have this additional term. That guy can give rise to magnetic fields. Even if we start with a magnetic field equal to zero, the two are going to be identically zero. They don't give you any contribution in the evolution of the magnetic field. In contrast, this part here is doing that. So you see that if the gradient of the electron pressure is not parallel to the gradient of the number density of electrons, then the V over the T can be different than zero, and we can have the generation of a magnetic field. Okay? Once you have the generation of the magnetic field, B is becoming different than zero, and the other two terms are going to be active. and it will contribute as well to the variation of the magnetic field. Okay? And with that, we basically have seen all equations that describe magnetohydrodynamics. So we started with the description of the plasmas. We modified the Poisson equation that expresses momentum conservations for our system, in this case the plasma. We modified the energy conservation by accounting for the fact that we have magnetic fields, and they give you a contribution of magnetic fields. The continuity equation is unchanged. So look now what we have. We have Poisson equations. These are three equations. Energy conservation, this is one equation. Continuity equation, this is a scalar, referring to a scalar for is again one equation. We derive the induction equation, which are three equations, because you see that is a vector, so that's a three equation. Again, the system is not closed, and to close it, we need what? A relation between pressure and density, which is given by the, the equation of state. Which is one equation. And the system is closed. Okay, what is missing here? The electric field. So it looks like the three equations are missing. Is that the case? No, because we have seen that you can link the electric field and the magnetic field through the Ampere's law and through the transformation of the magnetic field with respect to the rest frame of the fluid. Therefore, also this guy is constrained by using. So please give us the other three equations through Ampere's law. Ampere's law and the Lorentz transformation. As we did it here, you see? By putting together these three equations. And this is magnetohydrodynamics. Okay? So just, this is the full concept. You see that we have our full system. I just go fast through this derivation. We see that we want to look what is the evolution of the magnetic field. We use the induction equation as is given. What we need to do is to evaluate the electric field that is taking place, that is existing in our, in our plasma, which we relate to the magnetic field through Ampere's law. There is just steps, mathematical steps, that allow us to arrive at this result. And with this equation where we, initial equation where we assume that there is no displacement, therefore we have one fluid where the two species, ions and electrons, are perfectly titling, are moving as an individual fluid. We see that if we have no magnetic field at the beginning, there is no evolution of the magnetic field, therefore there cannot be creation of magnetic fields. Whereas we loosen the assumption of perfect coupling, they are still coupled, the fluids, but there can be some drift. Okay, there can be some small drift. Therefore, we need to account for two fluids now, for the positive and the negative particles, two Poisson equations. What we care about, you see, we are looking for the induction equation, therefore we need to look for the electric field. And this is going to be created by the drift. Therefore, what we need to study is the link between the drift and the electric field, which is just which is obtained by making the difference between the two Poisson equations. Plus, we had to introduce the fact that there are collisions between the two species, which also give an additional coupling, okay? Which is the yellow term up there. Then what we did was just an approximation, because we know that the mass of the electron, of the ions, is way larger with respect to the one of the of the electrons, and therefore the terms there are negligible. The yellow one that are barred there are negligible with respect to the equivalent contributions given by the electrons. We then assumed, I didn't write it there, but we assumed, you see that from the equation, the first equation there to the electron equal to, what we did there is to assume that the drift of the velocity drift is constant. Therefore, the time variation of the drift is equal to zero. Okay, so we assume that the drift is constant, something like that. Okay? And then we just isolated the magnetic field that give us the time evolution of the magnetic field, which is the big equation there. Then what we did is just a little bit of math, nothing physics, no physics is really going on there, but by applying the product rule of derivatives, we basically identified terms that are negligible, that we dropped, and we arrived at the end at the final expressions. If you now compare this expression with the drift and this expression without the drift, you basically realize the fact that there is one additional equation, or one additional term, sorry, which is the first one that I marked with the box, which can give rise to magnetic field even if you start without magnetic fields. So plasmas, when you are considering drifts, can generate magnetic fields. Okay? And even if you start with the magnetic field equal to zero, you can have a generation of magnetic field, but this is not guaranteed, because what we need is that that cross product is different than zero, which is the case if the gradient of the pressure of the electron is not parallel to the gradient of the density of electrons. So you need a little displacement between the two components. Otherwise, as well, you don't have generation of magnetic fields. Okay? So that's all about it. Good. We can have a short break. We can, I would like to close the lectures today. Okay, I'm sure that you are happy. I see that you came out of you. So we can start in 5 minutes, okay? In 20 past 10, we can resume the lecture.